Come over to this side, please. There's a lot of people who are coming to the graveyard for this Jumu'ah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So this graveyard which we are currently in, we are currently on the left side of Masjid al-Aqsa. So on this raised wall in front of us, just on the other side, we have the Aqsa complex. So our hotel, when we go further down, you're going to see our Golden Arches Hotel. Okay, this graveyard is significant for a number of reasons. Many of the Mujahideen are buried here, but the reason we have come is because there are two companions of the Prophet who are buried herein. Normally when we think about the graves of the companions, may Allah Ta'ala be pleased with them, we only associate them with the graveyard of Jannatul Baqi. May Allah Ta'ala enable us to be buried there.
Ameen.
But the truth is that companions of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam are buried in various locations throughout the world. For example, in Istanbul we have that great companion Sayyidina Abu Ayyub Al-Ansari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Why is he special? What khidmat did he do? Anyone know? Come on, people. At the time of Hijrah, he hosted the Prophet ﷺ at the time of Hijrah. When the Prophet ﷺ arrived in Medina, he stayed in the house of this great companion, Sayyidina Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. But that wasn't his real name. His real name was Khalid bin Zayd from the tribe of Banu Khazraj. And also, apparently in China, I've not been there, but what I've been told, you have the grave of Sayyidina Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. In this cemetery here, we have two companions of the Prophet ﷺ. Before I speak about who they were, just to give us an understanding, this is an issue of creed. The doctrine of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we believe that the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, are the greatest individuals after the Prophets. The companions, they are the greatest individuals after the Prophets. The Prophets are the greatest. And then of the Prophets, you have the five Ulul Azam. And then after the Prophets and the Messengers, we have the Sahaba, who have the highest status. If we were to take one hair, or let's go forward. Further, if we were to take one speck of dust under the shoes of one companion, I swear by Allah, all of us combined with our years of praying, of fasting, of Hajj, we will not be able to equal that one speck of dust. And my beloved teacher, Sheikh Bilal, may Allah Ta'ala preserve him. He once said a few years ago, that the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, when they explain the virtues of the Sahaba, the ulama, they say that if every scholar on the face of this earth, Imam Bukhari, Imam Abu Hanifa, Ghazali, all of these scholars were to be placed on one side of the scale, but one companion was placed on the other side, then he would outweigh everything that they have done. Why? Because Allah Ta'ala has sanctified their position in the Quran where he said, Radiallahu anhum wa radu an. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. What is it that makes the companions different from other people? What are the conditions of being a Sahabi? Number one, they must have met the Prophet ﷺ after he received Nubuwwah, and they must have been in the state of Iman. So they must have met the Prophet after he received prophethood. They must have been Muslims and they must have died in the state of Iman. Unfortunately, a lot of people met the Prophet before he was given Nubuwwah. So they won't be counted as Sahaba. Then there were others who met the Prophet, but they didn't accept Islam. Then there were those, like Ka'b al-Ahbar, who met the Prophet, but didn't become Muslim until after the Prophet left from this world. So they were not regarded to be from the companions. So I'll say it again. The companions, to be a companion of the Prophet ﷺ, you must have met the Prophet in a wakeful state after he received Nubuwwah. They must have been in the state of Iman and died upon Islam. Because a lot of the Sahaba left Islam after the Prophet ﷺ passed away. So obviously within the companions, they have different ranks. Obviously number one is Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Then we have number two, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The two of them, we refer to them as the Shaykhain, the two elders. Then Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, then Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. These are the four Khulafa. Then we have the Ashara Mubashara. Who are they? Someone tell me, who are the Ashara Mubashara?
Umar radiallahu
anhu. Who were they?
The ones who were promised Jannah.
Yes. They were the 10 companions who were given the glad tidings of Jannah in one sitting. Then we have the 313 companions who took part in the Battle of Badr. The Battle of Badr, the first decisive battle in Islam. The Prophet said regarding those Sahaba who fought in Badr, all of the sins that they have committed have been wiped away, and anything they do until the time of death will be wiped away. So then we have the Muhajireen and the Ansar. Muhajireen were those who migrated from Makkah to Medina. Then we have the Ansar who were present in Medina. When the Muslims migrated from Makkah to Medina, the Prophet ﷺ, he paired people up. So he said, okay, you go with this person, you go with this person. So what the Ansar did, they divided their property into half, and they gave half of it to their partner. So for example, if they had 10 bags of wheat, 5 they'd give. If they had 10 camels, 5 they'd give. And some of them, many of us won't be able to understand this, many of them even went to the extent that they divorced some of their wives so that there were women for the Muhajirin to get married to. So, in this graveyard, one companion we have is Sayyiduna Ubadah bin Samit, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He passed away at the age of 72, 34 years after Hijrah. And he accepted Islam at a very amazing time. So approximately 1 year before the Isra and Mi'raj, a group of about 6 people, they came to Makkah and they performed the pilgrimage and they met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they accepted Islam. Then the next year, they came back with about a dozen or so people. This was known as the Pledge of Aqaba. So this individual, Sayyidina Ubadah bin Samit radiallahu anhu, was present at the time of Aqaba.